Okay, on page 24, the, focusing on praising God for what you believe is for. I think the Monday night group went over the, this past Monday night. Tonight, we want to give more stories and information concerning the importance of praising God for what you're believing for. Okay. I always go back to things that we have gone over in the past, and today I was looking over this little book again. In the forward, it says here, we are never to ask God for anything without thanking Him for what He has done.
Yes, yes.
That's a good point. We are not to thank God.
Yes.
We are not to ask God for what anything without thanking Him for what He has done. And it says that Psalms 104, it says, enter into His gates with what?
Thanksgiving.
So the first stage of our approach to God in worship should be thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. It should be thanksgiving. And that's a very important fact. And I remember Sunday when I was speaking about Daniel. Daniel was a person that was very strong in hidden things. If you got your Bibles, turn to Daniel 2. And 17, this is in reference to when Daniel received the message that all of the wise men were going to be slain if they weren't able to recall or interpret the dream of the king. And the Bible says that Daniel went in, the 16th verse, and desired of the king that he would give him time and that he would show the thing, the king, the interpretation. It seemed like Daniel was pretty sure that he would get a word from God. And he said, just give me time and I'll what? I'll show you what you dream, and I'll not only show you what you dream, but I'll give you the interpretation. So then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions. Those were the three Hebrew boys, that they would desire mercies of God, of heaven, concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. So I feel that in the process of getting the secret from God, there were a petition made or a supplication or desire that was expressed in form of a prayer. But I also believe that Daniel not only prayed three times a day, but he also gave thanks to God as well. All right, so the secret was revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Okay, so when Daniel got the word, the secret was revealed, what did Daniel do?
That's the God of heaven. Thanks.
Amen. He gave thanks. Amen. All right, do you think he was giving thanks before the secret was revealed?
Yes.
All right, so he lived a life of prayer and what?
Thanksgiving.
Okay. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are His, and He changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. And the 23rd verse, he says, I thank thee and praise thee, O thy God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might, and has made known unto me now what we desire of thee, for thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter. So you can see that Daniel was always giving God thanks, and he was always praising and exalting the name of the Lord. Amen. Now, I think that many times we are aware that we need to praise God for the things that he has done, but many times we are not as strong as praising God for the things that we want him to do. I'm going to give you another illustration of the importance of offering that sacrifice, which is praising God for the things that you are believing him to do. I'm going to give you that little story over in Jonah. I guess it's a lot easier to praise the Lord for the things he has done, right, than to praise him for the things that you want him to do. Okay, let's look at Jonah. Okay, let's look at Jonah. All right, for those of you that haven't read your meditation, you haven't read your Bible today, we just be helping you to get it in before the day is over. All right, chapter 2. Sister Hill, you are a pretty good reader, aren't you?
I'm pretty good.
Okay, that's pretty good.
Okay.
All right, let's see if you can read that for us. Jonah
chapter 2.
1 through 10. Okay. Chapter 2, okay.
Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly, and said, I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice. But thou hast cast me into the deep, in the midst of the seas, and the floods compassed me about. All thy billows and thy waves passed over me. Then I said, I am cast out of thy sight, yet I will look again toward thy holy temple. The waters compass me about, even to the soul. The depth closed me round about. The weeds were wrapped about my head. I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bars was about me forever. Yet hast thou brought up my life from corruption, O Lord my God. When my soul fainteth within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto thee, and to thine holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercies, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land.
Okay. How many remember the story of Jonah? Anybody can kind of recapitulate that just for a minute? What had happened to Jonah?
Well, first thing, he was disembodied somebody else.
Okay, he was rebellious. God had told him to go to where?
Nineveh.
And he didn't want to go, right? And why didn't he want to go to Nineveh?
Because he knew that God would, he didn't want God to be sacrificial to those people.
He didn't want God to spare them.
Fair them.
Yes.
They were very, wicked cities.
Yes.
And he just didn't want to face those wicked people. So So he went another direction, and what happened?
He got shipwrecked.
He got on the ship,
okay.
Yeah.
So he got on the ship, yeah. said, I'm not going to do that, I'm going somewhere else.
Yes.
And after he got on the ship, what happened? The ship began to do what?
Rock.
Tossed to
and fro.
Yes, tossed to
and fro. Okay, ran into a storm.
Yes.
And what happened to Jonah?
They threw him overboard.
Okay, they threw him overboard. Why did they throw him overboard?
They
thought he was the one that what?
Yeah.
Okay. They thought the storm was resulted as a result of Jonah. I guess maybe they sensed that he was running from God or something. So they threw him overboard. And these first verses here, 1 through, then Jonah prayed unto the Lord. Well, 17th verse of the first. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights.
Yes.
That must have been a big fish, huh? What size fish would that be, Brother Buick?
That's a whale.
Yeah. That's a whale, right?
Jonah could have been a little guy, though.
Still a big fish.
Yeah. It must have been a huge whale.
Yes.
Okay, the second verse of the second chapter, third verse, the fourth verse, kind of describe the scenario that he experienced being in the belly of the whale. So it was a horrible sight. He said he cried out of the belly of hell, cried out, and thou heardest my voice. He was in the midst of the seas. The verse 3 said, the floods come past me about, the billows and our waves passed over him, and the waters come past me about, even to the soul. Mentioned about the weeds were wrapped around his head. Went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bars was about me forever. Yet thou hast brought up my life from corruption, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto thee into thine holy temple. So Daniel realized that the only way that he would be able to get delivered was that he would have to pray his way out. So prayer was kindled in his heart, and he began to pray. All right, verse 8, they that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. This is what he said. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy. Okay, what does that mean? Okay. I'd like for somebody to elaborate on that. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercies. Okay. So what was he saying? Jonah was saying what?
Believing something false.
Okay, if I accept the circumstances as they really are, I'm gonna what? I'm gonna forsake my mercy. In other words, there won't be no deliverance for me. If I'm gonna be governed by the circumstances that I'm at, that I'm confronting, and I'm gonna what? I'm gonna forsake my mercy. God is not going to deliver me. So he called the circumstances what? Lying vanities. Were these circumstances real?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Were they real?
Amen.
All right. But God had what? But God has also